So today I have a tip for you on play last. How do you get people to leave you alone? So you might not know what I'm talking about. In the objective personality community, you have animals, and my last animal is play. So I'm a consume, sleep, last, play. You will know what I'm talking about if you know what I'm talking about. If not, objective personality is really cool. You should check it out. I'll put a link in the description. So how do you get people to leave you alone? I think this is useful. I think it's useful if you are play last, then you're play last. And it's useful to know how to get people to leave you alone. But I'm kind of joking because it's also useful and healthy to push on your play last and challenge it and step out of your comfort zone. It is useful to challenge any demon. This is a census year, and as soon as I realized it was a census year, I became very, very concerned because that's like my worst nightmare. A stranger knocking on my door when they have not been invited, they haven't texted me first, they haven't made an appointment. That is an absolute deal breaker for me. So how do I get these census people from knocking on my door? I'm just really, really concerned with it. I've been like, you know, I talk about it a lot. My mom says that I bring it up a lot. I'm like really, really concerned with it. I actually filled out the census online and I posted it on my door so that if the census worker comes by, they will know for sure that I have filled out the census. I've done my due diligence and I filled out the census. So then maybe they won't knock on my door. In my studio next door, I use that as an art studio. It's where I actually do my production for Etsy. I'm making most of my money from Etsy right now, but I also see massage therapy clients there. So it is critical that nobody knocks on my door. It's not okay for someone to knock on my door during a massage therapy session. So I'm really concerned with it. But I'm also just concerned because that's my personality. That's my play last. When I was little, I was born in 77. As far back as I can remember, I always thought it was insane that we live in a society where a stranger can knock on your door without calling first and making arrangements. That's crazy. I grew up in an era where people did come over to borrow eggs and borrow sugar and borrow a cup of flour. That was really normal back then. So that was a little bit more acceptable to me. But there were also like salesmen would knock on your door and try to sell you stuff. Vacuum cleaner salesmen, knife salesmen, people selling like household cleaning products, not to mention Jehovah's Witnesses, people proselytizing. To me, this is absolutely unacceptable. It is not okay to do that. And I always felt that way. I remember thinking that even when I was 5 years old. Now, when I was five, my parents were home. And so they answered the door. But here's an example of how sometimes you have to push outside of your boundaries. That is actually how I met one of my best friends in my whole life, is that she came over and she knocked on the door and she said, "Do you have any little girls I can play with?" And that's really sweet. And I've lost touch with her. I don't know where she is right now. But that was great. You know, that's really sweet. Even though that's my last animal, and even though I hate it when people show up unannounced, that is how I met one of my best friends. I do have a lot of strategies for getting people to leave me alone. In my small business, there are a lot of systems put in place to prevent people from getting to me. It's incredibly draining to me to interact with other people and collaborate with other people. Although my customer service is really good, people can get to me. There are just barriers put in place where it's harder to get to me. It's harder, but also the information is all there. All of the sensory is spelled out on my website. All of the answers are there. If you look at the website, you will get the information really easily. Unless you're like an extreme consume last, and then, you know, you're not even gonna look. You're just gonna call me, probably. And I will get back to you. But I also have a whole lot of canned responses, you know? I find this on my Etsy store. People message me and they ask me for the information that is literally in the listing. And I literally copy and paste the listing and send it back to them. Or, you know, take the listing photo and send it to them. And I'm very polite about it. "Oh, hi, Becky. Thank you for your question. As you can see from the image posted, the blah, 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 whatever question she's asking," which was in the original posting to begin with. She just didn't read it because maybe she has a little consume. Anyway, I'm polite about it. I've gotten used to it. So I guess what I want to talk about is that it's okay to think of ways to protect your last animal or your demon. You know, if you're play last or sleep last or consume last, and that's just your jam, that's your natural way of being, that's fine. But also be aware, see where it's helping you and where it's causing problems, and push yourself outside of it sometimes and protect it when you need to. So I protect my play when I need to. I protect it a lot. My knee-jerk reaction when somebody asks me to collaborate is just to say nope, because I'm busy. I'm actually really busy. I do a lot of things all alone without the tribe. I am trying to stay focused on my mission. If I distract myself by saying yes to a bunch of things, yes to a bunch of tribe collaborations, it's just going to distract me from what I am trying to focus on. And what surprises me about collaborating with people is that sometimes it sounds really enticing. It sounds like, yeah, that would be cool. I think I might want to do that with you. And then it becomes complicated in ways that I never could have imagined. When you collaborate and interact with people, it's like it's weird complications come up. I'm just really self-sufficient in doing things my own way, doing things efficiently, and also sleep processing a lot while I'm doing it, which is a very solitary thing. It's a very alone thing. Any project that I'm working on or event that I'm going through, the sleep processing is a major part of the process. And that is something that I do alone. After I've sleep processed, I can tell you about it. I can blast about it after I've sleep processed it. But sleep processing like with someone or I don't know, that doesn't work. Not for me anyway. So I have pushed on my play last in my life. One of the major times when I did that was when I trained for the Eugene Half Marathon. For me, the race was a challenge, you know, running, training for a race was a challenge. But the real challenge for me was that I forced myself to train with a group. So it was a tribe thing. My normal process would be to look up training plans, pick a training plan, and execute the training plan on my own. I don't need motivation from the tribe in order to get up in the morning and put my running shoes on. All of that motivation is available to me just within myself. The race was a challenge in a way, but the real challenge was meeting up with this group on a regular basis. While I was going through that process, I was noticing what I liked about it, what was valuable about it, what I didn't like about it. I was noting if I would like to do this again in the future. In the end, I don't want to do that again in the future. I've been there and I've done that. When I trained for subsequent races, I did it on my own because that's just normal for me. I'm glad that I pushed myself out of my comfort zone and I did train with a group. That was, you know, somewhere that I needed to push myself, and I did. There's a really fine line. I feel like it's okay to protect that last animal, but you should also use your intuition and really listen to when it's appropriate to push on that and challenge yourself. I'm also just more often aware of my animals in general throughout any activity or process. I'll be aware of what my play last is doing, what it wants to do. Is that working in my favor or not? Are my play last tendencies making me more effective in this project or less effective? And what is my consume sleep doing? And what is my blast doing right now in this project? So I think just being aware of that can be helpful, and you can kind of see when it's time to challenge and push that a little bit. And when you just want to, you know, do your cruise control thing, just do your animals on cruise control, because a lot of times they work for you. I'm 43 years old. My animals serve me well in a lot of ways. I mean, I've figured out how to do my life with my animals. So like my consume sleep is incredibly valuable. I consume sleep all day long. So I'm making masks on Etsy. I'm sewing all day long. And before I was doing masks, I was doing, you know, other things. You can insert anything. I was always doing something physical, making something. I'm always making something. When it wasn't masks, it was something else. While I'm making things, I'm literally consuming and sleeping. I listen to audiobooks all day long. And I'm also sleep processing what I'm learning. And I'm connecting everything that I'm consuming to everything else that I'm ever consuming. And it's like big invisible cloud above my head of like all these, you know, any connections of everything I've ever consumed and learned in my life. And I love that. I love how richly connected everything is. And I figure stuff out. It's like that sleep processing figures things out. It comes to conclusions. And it literally sometimes happens while I'm asleep that, you know, answers come to me during a dream. My sleep processing is like turbocharged, and I love it because it's got my back. It's looking out for me. My sleep is like a guardian angel. It's guiding me. It's really the way the all of it works together, the consume, the NE, you know, and the sleep all working together is my guardian angel. It guides me. So my knee-jerk reaction when people ask me if I want to collaborate on a project is just no, I'm doing something. I am always very, very deep into some project or process that I'm very, very involved with in my life. And I don't have to be. Often it's not work-related at all. It's just I am curious. I am deep into this project because because it's what I'm exploring, what I'm learning, because I want to be doing that. But there's also a voice inside of me that tells me sometimes when somebody asks me if I want to do something with them, that says, yes, pick this one. Even if it's not easy, even if it challenges my play, say yes to this one. And that happened recently, just out of the blue, somebody wanted me to coach them on a specific issue. I've never coached anyone. I mean, no one's ever paid me for coaching before. What it sounds like she wants help with is habits and organization, organizing physical reality and organizing life, you know, just SI stuff. SI is my last function. It's my smallest function, but it's also double activated and masculine. And it does not come naturally to me. When I look at myself when I was younger, the SI was, I really didn't have a handle on it. I was so overwhelmed by finding the most logical procedure and organizing things in the physical world. Like with my mouse that I'm making, not only is SI a huge part of the production, I also love it. I kind of geek out on it. The way that I make the mouse is really systematized so that I can at any point stop and pick up right where I left off. And it's not about making one mask from beginning to end. That's not what I'm doing. I will cut out parts for an hour, and then I will sew seam A for an hour, one seam over and over again. And then maybe next I will sew seam B. It's just phases of the process. It's like if this was being done on an assembly line, there would be maybe like 100 workers doing 100 different things. I'm doing all those different things, but only one at a time. If I get interrupted or it's time to eat lunch, it's fine. Stop what I'm doing. Go eat lunch. I come back. I pick up right where I left off. I love the SI of that. It's beautiful to me to find the most efficient method to organize all those parts. I love it. And I think that is why I'm suited to help this person who asked me for help with organizing her life and, you know, some physical things in her life, because I used to be bad at it. It used to be overwhelming to me when I was younger. I traveled from point A to point B. And because I wasn't good at it, I was really conscious while I was traveling from point A to point B. And so I can tell her what I did and how I got there. And I do still feel overwhelmed sometimes, but I have a process that I use when I feel overwhelmed by physical things and the physical reality. I can talk myself down from that feeling of overwhelm. I have a very conscious system that I use for doing that. I said yes, because I really do think that I can help her. And I think it's a great opportunity to do a little interaction with the tribe, expending some energy to see what I can learn from it. She knows that I've never done this before, and she's okay with that. She still wants to pay me for it. So my first session with her is in a couple days, and the goal for that session is to just listen, to try to really hear what she wants help with and what her goals are. I'm not very good at speaking extemporaneously, but I do have a lot of this habit and discipline and organization stuff loaded. It's just loaded and ready to go because I've thought about it so much. And so I'm sure some of that will come out. And then my process will be to consume sleep on her issue. I usually only consume sleep on my own issues, but I will do that for her. And then as I think of things to tell her that might be helpful, I'll get back to her, you know, send her some more emails and notes on her issue. And then, you know, maybe we'll have, I don't know how many meetings we will have. I've never done coaching before, but she picked me. And so I was like, why not? Sure. I'll give it a try. I'll do my best. And that's a little bit out of character for me to say yes to something that's totally unexpected. That does have to do with interacting with the tribe. I would consider that like a play kind of thing to say yes to. I am very busy because I'm focused on Etsy. That's where the majority of my money is coming from. I do have a few massage therapy clients, but I'm not taking new clients. And I'm only seeing one client per day, and not even every day. I'm being very cautious. They're projecting some pretty crazy numbers for mid-August. So I'm just kind of like stepping back and watching. I am busy with Etsy, and Etsy makes the majority of its sales in September, October, November, December. They just make more money during that time. So I need to have my listings solid. They need to be ready to go, and I need to have inventory. What, you know, Etsy shop owners are doing right now in August is like they're making stuff for Halloween. You know, you have to think about this really ahead of time and get your shit really organized. So that's what I'm doing. In my mind, before this girl asked me for help with the consultation, in my mind, I was thinking like, say no to everything. Say no to absolutely everything because Etsy is the focus. When she asked me this question, there was just like there was a yes inside of me. The answer's come from inside of me. And it just felt like a really strong yes. Like, yes, do this. Yes, it will be challenging. Yes, it will be uncomfortable. It might set off some kind of imposter syndrome kind of things because, you know, someone's paying me to coach them and I've never done it before. So I don't want to feel like a fraud or like I'm just really important to me to do a really good job. So I said yes to that one. But at the same time, I put that notice on my door for the census worker so that they will not knock on my door because I don't say yes to everything. I think it's okay to have a hard no. And for me, someone showing up unexpectedly is a hard no. It is just absolutely unacceptable. I will hate you forever if you knock on my door and you don't have an appointment. Anyway, don't knock on my door. And protect your play or your last animal, whatever. You can apply this to anything. Check in with all your animals and see what they're doing. See like how they're helping you and how you maybe could benefit from challenging them. Oh, hi, Cedar. This is my Cedar boy. Yeah. Hi. I'm talking to myself again. Anyway. That's that. Take care.